start from scratch. I'd like to welcome you all to what I think will be an exceptionally interesting and timely talk. We like to take on big questions. And the big question that we're going to be looking at today is Islam and Europe. It's always been a big question throughout the history of Western civilization and Islamic civilization. Islam and Europe have been near neighbors, trading partners, and sometimes warring partners. They've influenced each other a great deal. And today, they present, because of the unparalleled movement of peoples throughout the world, something that has never been possible on the scale that it now occurs, a series of challenges, challenges which affect both parties in the equation, both Islam and Europe. We're very privileged today to have someone whose scholarship and experience has given him unusual and notable insight into the issues that now face Europe and to some degree the United States, which has a growing Islamic population, the issue of integration. Dr. Sam Cherribi, and again, just to give you his biography, I think will tell you a great deal about the breadth of vision that he has on these matters, was born and raised in Morocco, got his baccalaureate degree there from the University of Rabat, came with other members of his family to the Netherlands, settled in the Netherlands, pursued a doctorate in sociology at the University of Amsterdam, received his PhD there, got involved in politics. Indeed, his whole family, I've learned, has been involved in politics on various sides of the political spectrum in the Netherlands. He has a brother who has been active in the Social Democratic Party, which is called the Labour Party, in the Netherlands. And he himself was a member of the Liberal Party. And the term liberal has a somewhat different meaning in Europe, you may know, than it has here. In Europe, it basically means, though, again, like many of these terms, it's undergone an evolution, it basically means an interest in freedom and in the market. The classical liberal parties of the 19th century, out of which contemporary European liberalism grew, were free trade, free market, freedom-friendly political organizations. He was a member of the Liberal Party there. He was twice elected to the Dutch Parliament, to the House of Representatives. He's also been involved in European institutions. He's been a member of the Assembly of the West European Union, which is a separate organization from the European Union, and also from the the Assembly of the Council of Europe. So he's been deeply immersed in European politics and all of its issues. He came to the United States about a dozen years ago, has held since then an appointment, or for a long period of time at least, an appointment, a joint appointment at every university in the Department of Sociology and in the Center for Middle Eastern Studies. And he's been writing books. His first book, In the House of War, was about the Muslim experience in the Netherlands, and he is currently working on a book called Fridays of Rage, or is it Rage on Friday? So I got that right, Fridays of Rage, which is about the effect of Al Jazeera and social media on mainly on the Arab Spring, though also, I believe, on the Muslim population in Europe. So this is a man with a wealth of knowledge and a wealth of experience, and here to talk about something that a great many of us think about, let me introduce you to Dr. Sam Cherribi.
Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
It's a pleasure and an honor to be here, especially here in West Texas. I heard a lot about this Institute for the Study of Western Civilization, and I'm really impressed with the work that Steve Walsh is doing. He's an erudite man, and I told him when I was having lunch with him, because his hospitality is also amazing, I said to him, you have to franchise this institute. It has to be everywhere. Every single country should have an institute like this. Because of this institute, Western civilization, I cannot start with something else than talking first about a great thinker, philosopher, that influenced absolutely the Western civilization more than anybody else. And he's from Holland, from the Netherlands. He's Dutch, but he's also a success story, the story of a migrant in the Netherlands, Spinoza, Baruch Spinoza, the guy who in this small city of Amsterdam, which was at that time the beehive of Western capitalism, created something amazing. A way of thinking, challenging Western civilization, and actually created, you know, the foundations of this civilization. And I will say why. One of the great writers, he's a professor at Princeton now, he's a Brit, his name is Jonathan Israel. Jonathan Israel wrote a book called Radical Enlightenment. And he said, when people during the French Revolution were saying, let's have the revolution, or even when Rousseau was talking, they had actually the echo of the work of Spinoza in their head. The same thing for Britain. When the British claim that enlightenment is British, they forget something else. They have the echo of the work of Spinoza in their head. Actually, what is called little enlightenment started in this country of Amsterdam,
it's not working.
Maybe the other one. Sorry, my clicker is not working.
There you go.
This is Baruch Spinoza in the epicenter of the city, in 1632, died 1677. He was born actually just 2 years after another great philosopher who spent his time in Amsterdam, who was, I'm saying that just because of Steve Walsh, and then I'm going to go to the story about Islam and Europe. He was the French philosopher René Descartes, who everybody knows, and I don't need, he came here 2 years actually before Spinoza was born, and both influenced actually, Western civilization, and I'm going to stop here about that. I'm going to talk a little bit about these are the things I want to talk about today. Sorry about this. What? Sorry. How to go back now? Sorry, this is the first slide. I can't go back. Yes. I want to do some reflections on Islam in Europe. Talk about the Dutch example, and then talk about something that everybody wants to talk about, is Europe and homegrown terrorism. And it's a problem that's also very important in America, etc. But however, what is the relationship with Islam and Europe? What is the end? Is it like Dick and Jane relationship? Or is it, as Steve Walsh said, or is it a contentious relationship? And this is what I want to try to talk about today. But before that, let me define first Europe, talk a little bit about Europe, the European Union, and then go to talk about Islam and the problems. Let's talk about the European Union. First of all, the European Union is a success story. The Berlin-Paris axis replaced actually the Brother Karamazov, the hatred between Germany and France. When Portugal and Spain joined the European Union, they became a huge economic miracle. And then also, it's the end of the Soviet threat, and Europe, Germany has been unified, Western Germany, Eastern Germany, together for the first time. It's the European Union that paid for it. since 2004, 12 new nations, and now we have 28 countries in the European Union. It is a huge success story, except now we're going to talk about the Brexit in a minute. And, you know, there is a continuation actually about the enlargement. In that sense, you could say the EU has realized actually all the dreams of the founding fathers. Jean Monnet, Robert Schuman, these are the founding fathers of the European Union. The sixth European Union became, six, from six to nine, to 12, to 15, 25, and then 28. It means, and it's not anymore only an economic community, but it is much more than that. And we're going to talk a little bit about it. It created actually the euro, and you know, the euro has been introduced. Nobody, you know, makes that link just after 9/11, which during 9/11 actually, EU has still a problem with political identity. It's not new. This is, you see here, Jerry Paxman wrote a beautiful book called The Englishman, and you see the Queen of England with Sarkozy, and he was the anchorman of the BBC Newsnight. And he always used to say Britain and Europe. And when the French, when the Queen visited actually France, especially Sarkozy, she spoke about the hysterical relationship between Britain and the EU. And not historical, but hysterical. And you see, it was all indicative to the relationship. Anyway, they show that everything, I mean, just between the British and the French and the Europeans, that not everything is harmonious. There is a field of competition for power, and there is a lack of leadership, because in the past you had France and Germany who could work together and work in tandem, and this axis has been in a way a little bit broken, especially because Germany became the engine of the European Union. France lacked in economic development and a number of things. However, France is still a very important country because of its military might. It's, economically, it's. sorry about this. I'm gonna take some of the book. I'm from Atlanta. It's. I love what Madeleine Albright always saying about the European Union. She said, in order to understand the European Union, you have to be French or to be a genius. And absolutely. It is, a lot of things are hidden in the European Union. When Zapatero of Spain, Prime Minister, was elected, the first thing he asked is to recognize the Catalan as a language within the European language. And now Catalonia wants to see. And now we are promoting all what we call, European regionalism. England with Scotland and the Basque region and Europe is still a... And then we have a history of failed referenda, the French one, the Dutch one. We're going to stop, anyway. In one of the former Eurocommissioners, Fritz Bockstein, he was the commissioner for the internal market. He said, the enlargement of the EU is so problematic because if we enlarge the EU so quickly, Europe will break and we will have two-speed Europe. He said this 10 years ago. And what we see now, Europe is breaking. We have, after the Brexit, we may have the Nexit, we may have the Frexit, but hopefully it's not going to happen. Even the euro is not the currency of all the European Union, only but a number of countries, and it is a big problem. Okay. The challenges ahead. Europe is divided between, just like in America before, but America had this debate a long time ago. Everybody who reads the Federalist Papers, between Federalists and non-Federalists. And the UK was one of the countries that was a non-Federalist. They encouraged Europe, etc. But Belgium, for example, because of the linguistic struggle within Belgium. Belgium, you have French speaking, Flemish speaking, you have a French prime minister, you have Belgian prime minister, Flemish prime minister, you have a German speaking community. And even if you go to the Belgian consulate or the Belgian embassy, which is, I love Belgium, I love the bread, Belgian fries, and Belgian food, etc. But you still, you know, we see that a country that has this linguistic struggle, in addition to, for example, Brussels as a city, which is the epicenter of the European Union, has a different identity than the rest of Belgium. Okay, there are tensions between federalists and anti-federalists, and all they used Europe or the enlargement or against the enlargement just to solve their national problems. Okay, let's say the EU implications, because the EU added many countries, and now Serbia is on the list. Other countries, Turkey, we're going to talk about it if you don't mind. After this, I'm going to talk a little bit about Turkey, because there is the contention between Islam and European Union. France and Germany would have actually less to say because of 28 countries. This is what explains why Angela Merkel recently decided in a way to have this talk with Erdogan of Turkey alone without the European Union, without even France, to show the only person who was present was actually the Prime Minister of the Netherlands, Mark Rutte, because this is also very interesting. Europe, you know, has a presidency, a rotating presidency, and the Dutch was president, had the presidency of that every 6 months, rotating presidency. Until a couple of years ago, Europe didn't have a president. Just now they have a president. But nobody knows the name of the president. The first president, you can break your tongue, pronounce his name. And they all come from a small country. The word from Luxembourg, the first from Belgium, the first one, Herman de Rompuy, and if you pronounce it in Dutch, is Herman de Rompuy. And now, you know, we have a different one. You know, I just want to say, the political configuration as a system is a problem in Europe. There is sometimes you have single issue coalitions, and that's why you see Hungary, for example, behaving like a dictatorship. Orban is now absolutely almost a dictator in a way, a dictatorship within the European. The same thing Poland. What Poland was tolerant in the past is now different, and we see religious issues coming up. Poland would love to introduce again the idea of God in the European Constitution that has been rejected in the past. Anyway, Europe will never have one foreign policy. Just remember the Iraq War, you know, was divided all Europe. Europe, you know, Dutch sent 400, soldiers, but they were not allowed to shoot. The Poland sent something, the other French said no. You know, so if Europe didn't make one single foreign policy when they were six, and they were 12, they were 15, 25, 26, 29, we never have it. It's going to be just a utopia. And that's what we have to I'm just talking here about the limits of what Europe can do. And then we have the problem with the enlargement of Turkey. If Turkey gets in a couple of years, it's going to be 90 million people, and Europe is afraid that Turkey will play the population card. And just now, there are talks again between Turkey and the European Union about the enlargement. Turkey, the Prime Minister of Turkey, the President of Turkey, actually, I'm going to talk about it in a minute, said that we will have a referendum too about joining the European Union or not. And if the people said we're not going to join the European Union, we're going to go to join a different economic configuration in Asia, for example, with China and other countries. And that's why one of the things, you know, because Turkey is in big trouble regionally with the migrants, with the refugees, its proximity to Syria, proximity to other hot places, you know, and the president of Turkey went to Russia to talk to Putin to smooth out the things. Okay, let me just now, one of the most important things to understand, this is the key to understand the European Union, what do countries understand with the word integration or enlargement of the European Union? For the French, they think being part of Europe is a French ambition. For the British, and we see that with the Brexit now, they see it as a free trade zone. For Spain, it's a source of money. For Germany and for Poland, it's a source for self-respect after the Second World War. And these are the keys to understand the self-interest behind the European, every single European country. Well, there is the guy of Guy Verhofstadt was Prime Minister of Belgium. He said, Europe is not sexy, it's the work of, you know, diplomats, bureaucrats, and not technocrats. And this is exactly what the big problem of Europe now. It is not made by the people. That's why you see the rise of radical right, populist, if you could say, populist movements, because the voice of the people is not really in Europe. And until recently, the European Parliament didn't have any power. There was, and even the elections of the European Parliament, you know, draws very few people, and the turnout is very low, very often. Let's have a little trip, and just to explain to you, go from Amsterdam to Brussels, and maybe to Cologne, see how they deal, for example, with the Islamic question. In Amsterdam, or in Holland in general, we have Article 23 of the Constitution. You can have Christian schools, Catholic schools, Islamic schools, Jewish schools, liberal schools, public schools, whatever. You can go to a school, for example, an Islamic school, and then the headmaster could tell you, if you don't wear a veil, a headscarf, you cannot teach at that school as a woman, or you cannot, as a teacher, as a student, get in the school. Okay. Drive a little bit, take the train, at least, go to Brussels, Holland, Belgium is a totally different country, in a way, since 1973, Islam has been recognized as a state religion, got a lot of possibilities to do. It deals with Islam in a totally different way. Even in Catholic schools, something like that, you have to teach courses on religion and Islam or other religions. Anyway, religious. You go to Paris, totally different landscape. What is it? Headscarves are not allowed. There is a huge debate since the 80s about the headscarf that metastasized into a different debate about the veil, about the burqa, and then recently about the burkini, and it is so contentious. And the whole idea of Islam actually being there in the public sphere in any form can make and break politicians. And here we're going to give you an example of why, for example, this is an example today, is what happened in... I will come back to this move. Anyway, what I want to say from this trip, and then we'll go back to France, sorry, is that you have a lot of EU pros. All the words like transparency, unity, cooperation, national interests, and there is no common policy in the European Union how to deal with Islam, or in the public space, or institutionally. Every country does what, you are obliged to wear a headscarf maybe in an Islamic school in the Netherlands, but you are forbidden, you cannot do the same thing in France. You could say, well, this is diversity between countries, but there are so many rigid lines that doesn't make it as a real European space, and because European directives most of the time are imposed on countries and they have to be implemented within a couple of years, and you see that that on the refugee issue, on very big issues dealing with that identity. That's why now the idea of the notion of identity and the problem of identity is biting your back, because they never dealt with the problems of identity in a serious way, except for making directives, etc. Anyway, This is President François Hollande making couscous. And here, it's a kind of couscous called bread called dari, like berry, it's like it rhymes. And they say, well, this is the people who don't like François Hollande, the president of France, want him to lose. They associate him with somebody who's like helping too much the Muslims. And then you just want to say how it's becoming so problematized. The same thing for today, François Fillon, who's going to be, for the first time, in the Europe, if you could say, the French wanted to, because there is a kind of Americanization of Europe, they wanted to have primaries, exactly like the American primaries. And they organized that by caucus, by party, or, you know, the right, you know, they changed the name of their party, they don't call it anymore UMP or RPR or something like that. They call it now the Republicans. And they had seven candidates. And after the first round, one of the important people who were running was two people were running, actually very, very famous. One of them is Nicolas Sarkozy, was actually lost. And then you had two people left, one who made the surprise called François Fillon, who ran against on an anti-Islamic ticket. The other guy, Alain Juppé, I will show his picture in a minute. Alain Juppé was the mayor of Bordeaux, who was prime minister in the past, and he wants to have a moderate way of dealing with Islam. And in his city, Bordeaux, he has an imam called Tariq Oubrou, and he dealt with him in an interesting way. And then with the people who hate Alain Juppé, they call him Ali Juppé, like from Islamic name, and then they go and they show him in a picture as a bearded person. And that's why he said, anyway, if you touch Islam, you're gone. And this is one of the things. This is François Hollande here with these American GIs who he's pretty small. That's why I showed this picture. He's small, big American guys who saved actually France. When during this train attack, terrorists wanted to attack the train, they were on vacation and they were awarded medals. And here I say again, America saved Europe again, not only in the first Second World War, but also I love the picture. It's fine. The president's so small. Okay, all right. Now, how to read these problems in the European Union? Okay, I say Europe is going from crisis to crisis. There is of course, also an Americanization of Europe because we saw and we have problems with the welfare state as it functions now, because people see the limits of the function of the welfare state. They cannot function. There is huge youth unemployment and huge unemployment everywhere in Europe, even in countries like the Netherlands, but Germany doesn't have a real youth problem because it doesn't have a big youth bulge as in France and other places. And that's one of the things that people maybe sometimes don't see. And then I just spoke about the primaries. I said they're going to show the picture. Sorry, I changed a little bit my slides. Let me see here. So I have a problem with this slide, with the mouse. It's not clicking. Sorry, oh, it's going back. The next one, I don't know. The next one, I don't know. The next, sorry about this. Yeah. Okay, let's look at the events. Today, for example, there were, documents revealed massive attacks on Europe. They were revealed in the newspaper. It means Europe has to deal with this. We know there are problems with the Brexit. Britain left the European Union, and it is another crisis. This is another crisis when, in Belgium, for example, the small region, the French party region in Belgium, refused to sign the agreement, the transatlantic agreement with Canada. It happened later, but it took time. you know, after the Brexit, the Dutch are the far right, or we call them the populists, want to have an exit, leaving the European Union. You know, we had, there is a crisis of the euro, there is a crisis of the migration, there is a crisis of the Schengen, which is Schengen is this you know, this free space within the European Union where we can travel without passport or anything, without borders. Now you see Hungary impose borders. A number of countries have policing, started to police actually their borders, which is actually, in a way, Schengen is becoming problematized. There is the presence of migrants in the cities is seen as a problem. Like, you can read about it daily in the newspapers. You know, that the presence, the weight of the numbers and the presence. Let me just say, this picture that everybody knows about, we became a symbol of the refugees from Syria who've been drowning in Europe, that it's helped actually, because in 2014 Angela Merkel didn't want to have the refugees coming to Europe, to Germany. But this picture of this young person, this is work of art taken by a made Angela Merkel really accept. You know, in my view, Angela Merkel needs to have a Nobel Prize for what she did in Germany. Anyway, you see the numbers of people, of refugees, since 1973. There is now, you know, we see a peak in 2015 again, exactly like almost in the 90s here, because of a number of crises, Algerian crises, and also other refugee crises in the past. But the in 2016, it's getting there. I just showed you the number of you know, people who are asking for you know, a refugee status in Europe. This is Juncker from the European Commission, and this is Erdogan from Turkey. And I want to talk a little bit about the contentious relationship between Turkey and the European Union. Because for a long time, Turkey wanted to become member of the European Union, and it has been, you know, when Turkey was part of, if you could say, when the threat of the Soviet Union was big, Turkey was seen as a buffer zone, and every European politician for 40 years almost were saying, you're going to join the European Union as long as you are compliant. And what happened, actually, when Erdogan came was, in a way, the Recep Erdogan, who was prime minister and now president, did something really amazing, which is use the weight of the European Union and the pressure of the European Union to reform a number of things, including the military. The military in Turkey has been reformed because actually of his work, he did. But still, Turkey has a problem. It saw a number of countries from the Eastern European Union joining the European Union, but Turkey didn't join the European Union. And here, that's why Erdogan said, is it an Islamic, you know, a Christian club and not Islamic, and they don't want to have Muslims in it. But in a way, I will explain in a minute about the authoritarian drift of Erdogan, and about the way he wanted to reform actually the country after the failure of the Arab Spring, his failure in the Arab Spring, to become the big regional leader as he wanted to do, and how he wants after that to join the European, to put pressure continue more pressure about the European Union. As you know, the European Union, Angela Merkel promised him to give him $3 billion to solve the problem of the refugees, not to let refugees come through Turkey to him, to Europe, especially to Greece. And as you know, Greece and Italy was absolutely amazing in helping, solve the crisis, because the Middle East is very close to Europe. And the funny thing is that I say the relationship between Europe, between Islam, in a way, Turkey, and the European Union is like Turkish delight. It's sweet, it's nice, but it's sticky and difficult when you wanna take it out of your hands. This is the problem. This is, now the European Union doesn't want to deal with Turkey, and but they need Turkey, because Turkey is absolutely needed for the European Union. What? A lot of politicians say, well, because of geography, because of history, because of civilization, and maybe because of religion. But which is really at stake? This is what is Turkey in the map. You will see here, they say it is both in Europe and in Asia. That's why the Americans created the word Eurasia. But they say it is a little bit in Europe and a lot in Asia. As we know, Turkey from the start, from its inception, had the ambition to become European. And as you know, they changed the Arabic language to European language, to European, alphabet. The European music, especially classic music, European music, until the 80s was absolutely the only thing that you could hear on the national radio. But later, it changed, and we're going to talk about it in a minute. We're going to get back to this point in a minute. The problem of Turkey thinks that they did everything it needs to be done to be European, but just because of faith, of religion, that's why Europe is not helping them. Anyway, this is not very important, because when I go to more important things, the problem is other European nations or other European politicians think that Europe, that Turkey has a big population of Muslims, and it's going to change the total configuration of the European Union. Anyway, this is the European don't have the guts, if I can say, to say to Turkey, we need you just to be there. We can have a privilege, you can have a privileged relationship with us, but we cannot get you in. And this is the real truth. If we had a referendum in any European country now, I think Turkey would not be in. Not because, as you know, for example, radical right in the Netherlands was created not because of any relationship with Nazi past or with fascism or anything. No, the new radical right in Europe has even liberal, if you could say, roots. And for example, the PVV, the Party of Freedom, has been created because of Turkey. Run a first an anti-Islam ticket, on an Islam ticket, anti-Turkey ticket, because they didn't want to have Turkey join the European Union. And the gentleman, Geert Wilders, left actually his Liberal Party and creates his own caucus within the parliament, and from there, campaigning against Turkey first. And that's why Turkey is seen by a number of countries as, the horse of Troy. Yes. Let me see. I'm sorry about this. It's slow. I don't know why it's not. Do you think? Yes. Okay. Since Giscard d'Estaing, who created actually the European, what we call the kind of European constitution, it's not totally constitution, but the fundamental rights for the European Union. He in a way, when he was president of France, until he made that document when he was commissioned to do it, he was always promising Turkey to get to be part of the European Union. Anyway, now the European Union is saying this gentleman, Erdogan, is not really a democrat. He behaves like a sultan. He doesn't behave like all the media and politicians are focusing on the undemocratic traits of this man. Well, we have many other people who are not democrats in the European Union, especially Orban in Hungary. Anyway, a lot of people also think if Turkey joins the European Union, it's going to become this is the flag of Europe, is going to be more Islamic. Okay. I'm not going to skip something because I think I have a lot of things to say. Anyway, can Turkey join the European Union? I really think that all the politicians in their heart want to say no.
Okay.
And that's why I say we can't. And then we do put the German philosopher, I think it was Steve Bosch, would like it. Okay, this is going to go to talk a little bit about Islam, good numbers, and then define a little bit what I want to say. Well, this is the Belgium. In Belgium, you have, this is the map of Belgium and what we call the religious practice. Even if Belgium is a Catholic country, a lot of people don't go to church. They are Christian. In that sense, they are more Christian than Muslims, of course. But if we compare only the religious practice, there are more Muslims going to mosque than Catholics going to church. Okay, this is one of the things. This is a religious practice in France. This is something that I didn't do. This is published by the Standard, which is one of the best newspapers of Belgium. This is the map of France. The black districts is where there is more. Sorry about that, I can show you this one. I forgot about that. See? Technology. Here. The darker you have possibilities of homegrown terrorists living there. This is not new, this is a map done by the Ministry of Interior of France. Okay, today, as I said to you, François Fillon, who's going to run for president on behalf of the right, won on a 4 million people came to the primaries and won the election. This is the map today of the election. The darker, a lot of people voted for him. In that sense, this is a feast for democracy because the French decided to have to canalize their we have the same thing for the left, and then it's really also a feast for democracy because you will move towards more candidates that are endorsed by the people, just like a little bit more in America than in Europe, where you have some machinations within political parties and things like that, and then when the people speak, you have nothing to say. Okay, this is Fillon before he ran. I told you about that. And this is Alain Juppé. Here they call him Ali Juppé. And this is one of the things that he made him lost, is that his association with Islam, even if he had really good intention, he was one of a solid candidate, wanted to do that. Now, he's going to run against Marine Le Pen, maybe if she stays in the second round, and people think that he may, François Fillon, may win the elections. Not because if we had elections now in the polls, Marine Le Pen is very high in the polls, and she could win. But now, because he moved to the extreme center, he took all his agenda, even he mentioned some of the words she used actually for her campaign. Now people will think because he moved too much to the right, she on social issues she may move to the left, keeping the same ideas about Muslims and things like that, but moving to the left, giving people because he wants to have a smaller government, he wants to have minus 500,000 jobs, he wants to create more jobs and startups, and just do it. He talks about the American model as an interesting one, even if he's too pro-Russia. He's seen as somebody who's leaning towards Moscow a little bit. And he's seen next to Marine Le Pen, which is the leader of far right, Front National, National Front in France. Next to her is Geert Wilders in the Dutch parliament here. She visited him in Nijmegen, and he's going to be, if there were elections today in the Netherlands, he would have more than 30 seats, between 30 and 38, according, it depends on which polls you read. All other parties, liberals, to the socialists, would have really less to say in the parliament. And here, they say that there is Marine Le Pen, I think there is a coordination when it comes to their agendas, which is, we're going to talk about it in a minute. Anyway, as we know, this is Charlie Hebdo. It happened in France. These are the attacks. I'm not going to go in details about it because of the time. Since Charlie Hebdo, until now, the most recent one was the one in Nice, actually. This guy who drove a car, a truck in Nice. This homegrown terrorism guy, born in Nice, did what he did. I heard today a similar thing happened in America. It's really sad. This is what's happening. This is France. There are a lot of also Paris homeless people in a way. Okay, now we're going to do a little intermezzo and speak about when, and then talk about Islam. When is the first time Islam has been, if you could say, this continuous encounter between Islam and Europe. For the first time, even the word Europe, let me say Europe first, has been mentioned, was actually, here I'm going to show you, because I have another slide, which is next, 658, in a novel called The Life of Gertrude, and the word, the inhabitants of Europe appeared. The first time, before that, there was no. It was just a couple of years, actually, after the birth of Islam, because after 632, which is really interesting to say, Islam and Europe, have a similar, path. 100 years after the birth of Islam, there was the Battle of Poitiers, because in 100 years, Muslims went from, Arabia to Spain and conquered Spain, and there was the Battle of Poitiers with Charles Martel, who stopped the Muslims in Poitiers, and that's why actually the word first time the word Europeans has been coined as a word, and then of course another time where that's Jacques Delors, the first Euro commissioner of the European Union, was talking about it. He said, well, indeed, Islam has been created as the backdrop of the Battle of Vienna, 1683, when Austria won from the Ottoman Empire and defeated, since the siege of Vienna until something like that. And then you could say, then there was the sense of Europe. Europe, in a way, is constructed against Islamic identity. Well, European identity has been constructed against Islam. That's why one of the things it's hard to. Okay. This is the Battle of Vienna when I'm showing you this defeat of the Ottoman army. The crescent moon is the is the symbol of the Muslims. And at that time in Vienna, there was an Italian Capuchin. This is a story that Gilles Kepel likes to talk all the time, back mentioned in his books and his writings. Mr. Capuchin Marco was a clergy, he was Italian, living in Austria, and he created something called the cappuccino. The cappuccino we drink now, it was based on Arabic coffee and some white milk on it. And then because the Arabic coffee is so dark and so dirty, and put some nice Christian things on it. And this is, and then this is the moon again, crescent moon. All the bakers of Austria met and said, hey guys, let's bake the Arabic moon. And of the Islamic moon, this is what they made. Croissant, cappuccino. See, dipped in the cappuccino. And this is was something like just at the level of the symbols as we create. Okay, this is, let's talk about just, you know, about Islam in a minute. Islam, as I said, sometimes is seen as a religion, as a tradition, but also as what I call a site of struggle. Why? Because European instrumentalized Islam, but Islam has been also instrumentalized by different groups within Islam itself to use it for a different purpose. Like, for example, during the Battle of Algiers, because as you know, just give you a quick chronology of the Middle East. After 1916, which is the Sykes-Picot, and the French and the British decided to create all these countries, Lebanon and Syria and other countries, and bring somebody from south, from, you know, Mecca, the Sheikh Mecca, his sons, to run this Iraq and other countries. It was, in a way, the creation of Arab countries against the Ottomans. And even the word jihad, for example, has been mobilized a number of times by the French against, against the Ottomans. For example, in 1926, when the first mosque in Paris has been built, Ottoman France said, at least at that time, that French is an Islamic empire, and that's why they want to deactivate actually the idea of jihad, of, you know, religious war against the Europeans, and like that, the Ottomans are Turks in a way, to mobilize against especially the French, and maybe to do things against the British themselves, because even the idea of the if you can say Arabness that created later the Pan-Arabism has been created. It is not me who's saying that, but there's a famous professor at Collège de France. His name is Henri Laurence. Said really something about, you know, since Lawrence of Arabia, the Arab with nice white clothes and the camel and the tent and something like that, was all these images had been mobilized actually against the Turks. Anyway, the first, and then there was the colonization of all these Arab countries, and then came the decolonization, especially in the late 50s and the beginning of the 60s. That Algeria was the most bloody war. The colonization was until 1962, because France considered Algeria, la France d'outre-mer, as France in a way, and there were more than a million people living in the northern part of Algeria. They called them the Pieds Noirs, or people, the Black Feet. Anyway, the Battle of Algiers, it's a very famous movie that I'm going to talk about, and that this is, that led to this huge war between France and Algeria, because Algeria was colonized by the French since 1830, this huge, that killed 1 million people, died, and that's why the whole country, Algeria, because in France you have a lot of Algerians living there, I'm going to talk about it, led in a way to the departure of all the people, the French and the migrants from Italy and Spain who were living in Algeria, to go to live in France. As you know, this is 1962. Yeah, this is the Europeans who were living in France. And then this is Algeria at that time. 1972 in France was the creation of National Front, a radical party against Arab, against Algerians. And because all the French who went to live in southern France were in a way leaning towards him, he found in a way, if you could say, a constituency to do things against the migrants who came later, because later his daughter Marine Le Pen. That's why if you could look at the map, electoral map in France, you see the south is totally National Front, and they just show how. Things. I'm going to go through a number of events, international events, that really had a huge impact on Europe. Let me show you quickly. This is something between President Carter, Begin, and Sadat, 1979, very important date. But that date was also the date of the Iranian Revolution. Very important. Michel Foucault, great French philosopher, who wrote Archaeology of Knowledge and a lot of interesting books, he said that the Iranian Revolution would be something really important, and he was raving about it. But the French Revolution, the Iranian Revolution led to a lot of problems in Europe and the Arab world and the rest of the world in general. We'll talk about that. 1983, the first march of the Boers, they call them the young people living in the banlieues or in the suburbs of France, because there was a huge problem in the time of the French president François Mitterrand about joblessness, and he said, well, and they walked from Marseille, south France, to Paris, and saying we need equality, etc. And it was a huge warning. Nothing happened, actually. And you will see later, 1995, there were some huge problems in France. And 2005, the French riots. And then 2009, and then after that, terrorist attack. You will not see the link immediately between these. I'm not saying that all these people are, homegrown terrorists. No. There is a very small group of people who used actually this mass, this concentration of migrants to do what they did, because they were targeted by transnational groups who had to flee undemocratic countries in the Arab world. And this transnational group saw in Islam, and especially in the Iranian Revolution, a way to see Islam as a solution, and in order to bring, that's why you had all these terrorist groups later who were fighting first against the near enemy, and later it became the far enemy, and we'll talk about that in a minute, which was later the 9/11, and then other things like that. Just quickly, this is President Reagan, and this is a very important moment, when he was tearing down the wall. 1989 became important. These are the Taliban in the White House, this one like that. And then 1989, after this year, a couple of years after the Soviet Union collapsed, and then 1989 was the defeat, actually, of the Soviet Union army, the Red Army, and the creation of Al-Qaeda was created. And you could say, if 79 was an important date, and 89, because in 79, exactly 79, the Soviet Union went to Afghanistan, the war, and then a lot of people, only later we know about that a lot of young guys from Europe went to fight in Afghanistan. Okay. And then the defeat of the Soviet Union, the fall of the Berlin Wall, actually in 1989, the triumph of democracy in a way, but at the same time, we continued to work with undemocratic regimes in the whole Arab world. There is no singular democratic regime. And then, you know, I'm not here giving, saying terrorism was the only solution. No, no, no. The only problem is that, because of there were no more ideologies in the market. The Soviet ideology, the communist ideology was bankrupt, etc. There was only one solution, one ideology still in the market, which was maybe Islam could be the solution. It has not been presented. And especially if you know that the whole 90s in Algeria, which was very close to France, the whole 90s there was a civil war with Islamists, and there was a lot of slaughtering, a huge civil war, and you know that that France had a lot of terrorist attacks before 9/11 in France. The metro stations were attacked, something like that, because of the pressure of Islamist groups from France. Just quickly like that, 1989, also a very important date. Salman Rushdie. All you remember, Salman Rushdie was a professor at Emory University. He created satanic. He wrote the satanic verses, which showed actually the problems actually of Europe and Islam by itself, because if Europeans succeeded since the 18th century to de-link actually the relationship bit of the clergy and with the ruler actually and God by moving it that the idea of legitimacy from this. The sovereign to the sovereignty of the people in Islam, it never happened. And Islam still has this idea of revelation, very important. And this book is really talking about, in a literary way, about that relationship between the angel Gabriel, who brought actually according to the Islamic narrative revelation to the prophet, before at that time was not prophet yet, only when the revelation came he became a prophet. Before that he was just Muhammad, and when he got the revelation he became the prophet. Anyway, all this is about it, and then it showed the unsolved dilemma between Islam and the West, how in the past the British beheaded actually Charles in Whitehall and transferred the sovereignty to the people, and the French did it through the French Revolution in a different way by taking Louis XVI. In Islam it never happened. And that's why the idea of secularism as it is in Islamic configuration never took, because of, as I said, the history of colonization, decolonization, never had the time as it was in the time from the European mind, actually, before imperialism, etc., that to have the time to rethink, because it's a huge thing that the fact to introduce secularism and to move it from the clergy sphere to we the people, it's a huge revolution. It's absolutely a huge revolution of mind that never happened, and it's going to take time to happen. It's like, anyway, I just want to say that when I was member of parliament, I created the first strategy committee with a couple of professors and friends to put some pressure on the British to let Rushdie fly with British Airways. And British Airways was afraid to fly him everywhere because there was some pressure from Ayatollah, who, by the way, issued this fatwa for the killing of Rushdie. And you know that just recently, and under the previous president of Iran, Ahmadinejad, the ransom, was raised to kill Rushdie. Anyway, Rushdie was a colleague at Emory University for a couple of years too. It was absolutely a privilege to have him, to meet him, to see him in hiding in Europe, and to see him free, walking freely without, bodyguards at Emory University. Thank you. I have a lot of things to say. First, we'll go for very important. Gonna skip these kind of things, and then until 9/11, this is here, and then I'm gonna go to talk a little about the European. Do you have time? Because I have two topics to talk about: the Dutch example and the terrorism. If you want me to explain it, otherwise.
The Dutch example.
Just the Dutch example. Okay. All right. Let's talk a little bit about the Netherlands. It's pretty funny to say the Holland is a beautiful country. Honestly, it's a country that the Dutch say themselves is God created Earth and the world. The Dutch created the Netherlands. It is true, and also, it's not really new. Coming from Amsterdam, there is a beautiful book written by this guy called Russell Shorto, an island in the middle of the sea. And in that book, he says, if New York is a cool city, which is New Amsterdam, by the way, is New York. He said, if New York is a cool city, an interesting city, it is because the Dutch were there. They introduced this feeling of tolerance that existed in Holland before, because Holland has this long tradition. Amsterdam, where you had Jews, Catholics, Protestants living there, in a time where Protestants were persecuted in France, and many religious groups from Germany came to the Netherlands to live in this, as I said, this absolutely beautiful city. And for example, Jews, when they came to Amsterdam for the first time, they presented themselves as, Catholic merchants living in there, and then only later, when the Dutch knew they were not Catholics and they were Jewish, they were even better. They had to pay less taxes, which was really interesting. it's all about merchants. It's a country of traders, that very small country that have beautiful companies, Heineken, everybody loves it. Unilever, you had this small country, but it was the largest Islamic country in the world because Indonesia was part of it. Indonesia was the largest Islamic country and has, great philosophers and etc. Was very nice introduction. Dutch were also in South Africa and a number of places. I just want to show that after the Second World War, to rebuild the Netherlands, they invited a lot of guest workers from Italy and Spain, and then when Italy and Spain became more prosperous, they went to poorer countries and they brought people from Morocco and Turkey, and it was the first time they brought migrant workers to the Netherlands. Something similar happened in France, something similar happened in Germany. There is also a sizable Moroccan community in Belgium, Denmark, and Sweden. In that sense, you could say some of the North African, because of proximity, it's only 15 miles between Spain and Morocco, for example. It's not very far. There was no colonial ties between the Netherlands and Morocco, or Turkey, or Sweden, and other places. And they came here, and all these people really profited from the tolerance of the Netherlands. Let me just say one thing first, we'll continue. I'm just explaining a number, some pivotal events in the world, but Islam has never, ever been so free as in Europe and the Netherlands. Europe was absolutely fantastic for the creation of Islamic sites, even if they were sometimes problematic, but they opened churches. There is not even mosque in some old synagogues, in Amsterdam, the council of churches been very instrumental, was instrumental actually in helping mosques settle. In that sense, the establishment of mosques, etc., even though it was problematic, it was the created. It was there is, if you could say, Muslims have nothing to complain about when it comes to this kind of things. This is absolutely true. And the problem is, and this is what people don't know, is that the first generation, the second generation, was very happy in the Netherlands, etc. And then they were naive when they attracted the demands and other things. And then they were easily to influence by, first of all, the politicized organizations, by organizations from radical Islam, because they saw everybody as a Muslim and they didn't know people with agendas and things like that. And then it is this, if you could say, this meeting, this encounter of naive, you could say, people, villagers, people who came to work, just to work, and created the mosques for their identities and for prayer, and then being some infiltrated and then and created some kind of some mosque became radical later, and this is what I wanna talk about. I'm not gonna, because we don't have time, I'm not gonna go through the migration, and I have statistics about mosques. I can put it on the website of you, of the institute. Let me just go about. Okay. Three major developments since the 60s happened is actually, as they say, in the beginning, the mosques were really very controversial. And in the 80s, even member, prime ministers and politicians went to mosque to campaign for Muslims, for the Muslim vote, and they, at least in Holland, for example, at the local level, they gave the people the possibility to vote. And I remember Ed van Dijk, who was the mayor of the city of Amsterdam, one day said, oh, they actually, some people who are not Dutch were allowed to vote. And he said, oh, no worries, just the election. They are citizens, they pay taxes, and when they pay taxes, they can vote. And they allowed, and it was really, really an amazing thing just to show the level of tolerance there was in Netherlands. And then things changed, of course. That's why I spoke about international events that happened, the Gulf War, other places, that things that really radicalized some already radicalized imams and others to exert more influence on people. And this is what I call, Islam became more extrovert. The more extrovert, and then it became problematized, became part of public debate. Of course, a lot of the people who are anti-Europe, especially some of radical imams, if you want me, during the Q&A we can talk about that, rejected actually reason, which is the base of Western civilization, rejected actually integration, and rejected the idea of secularism. And in order to explain that, I would say Muslim communities in Europe, or anywhere, have what they call trifecta of coercion. There is a pressure from above, there is a pressure from below, and pressure, I can explain this theory, but I don't think you want to go into it.
It's okay, we should get to the question.
Okay, shall I stop now, or and then open the question?
Why don't we do that?
And then,
explain it in the context,
at least 20
of the,
slides
of the
yes.
question. So I'm sure there are a lot of questions, and if there are, raise your hand. We have a mic here, and we have to get over here. Okay, hold on for a moment. That works. Good work.
Thank you, sir. Earlier in your talk, you mentioned homegrown terrorists. What I think is really true is that there are no homegrown terrorists, that those who are nationals within a country and become terrorists become so because of the influences from outside that country,
exactly.
From radical Islam.
Yes.
It also seems that what used to be in Holland, assimilation of Muslims within the community,
yes,
has ceased.
Yes.
And throughout Europe, assimilation is not at all occurring, as far as I can tell.
Yes.
And does not that lead to further conflict between the Muslim communities and the nations wherein they're living.
Well, yes, it is. However, if you, for example, the problem is that it has been complicated with the rise of populism and far right and the media framing. When you have a drumbeat of far right saying we want less Moroccans, less Muslims, there are no trials again in the Netherlands, and then politicians say, yeah, we will make that happen. It resonates like fascism, it resonates like Nazi Germany, it's like the Holocaust ideas, and this is what makes really like drumbeat. There was so many writings and many discussion in the public space that problematizes Islam. Even people who are really good citizens, can be mayors of the city or doctors or something like that, are problematized. And then young people who have no jobs, etc., they think, oh my God, we will never be assimilated really in this country. And we tell you a lot of people who really speak perfect Dutch, who one of the writers, actually, I just read something she wrote. She always been Dutch. She doesn't speak Arabic. She doesn't go to mosque, anything. She said, I'm going to stop being Dutch because they don't want me here. I'm not accepted in this country. And everything, I mean, I will tell you two things, the difference between them. I have an experience in America. In America, when migrants become Americans, they become Americans. The American flag can rally everybody. That's it. You're American. When anybody, you know, attacks somebody who believes he's American, I heard people saying, stop, you cannot do that. It's impossible. In Europe, you can be Dutch all your life, third, fourth generation Dutch, but it doesn't have the same effect as the American flag. There is something wonderful about the American flag. There is something wonderful about the magical rallying character of the American flag. Dutch flag, the European flag has only stars. Nobody knows what it means. And you know, there is now the Brexit and things. I mean, it doesn't have the same effect. Honestly, I mean, if there is anything successful in America, it is the power of assimilation. It works differently than in Europe. I honestly think that. And this is, if there is something to learn from here, is that, you know, if you say, I spoke to a number of people, I say, are we that have jobs or just, you know, don't make much money even in Walmart? And they say, would you like to work for XP in Europe? At least you will have the welfare state, you take care of it. No, I want to take care of myself. I don't want the state to do anything. This sovereignty of the individual, of the, that happens in America, is only, it's like, you can have it in the air and you breathe it in the water, it's something like that. But here, with you domesticate people with the welfare state, and then you tell them you have nothing now because there is a downturn, there is a problem with the economy, and then, no, you have to be autonomous. Some people cannot do that. Here, just give you an example. When refugees come to America, they give them 3 months money, and 3 months, and they tell them, go away, find a way to find a job. In Europe, you are not allowed to work, even if you don't work for 10 years. If you are a refugee status, you can't, in Europe in general, something like that. And then they will pay you to stay, not to do anything. I call it domestication of people. They don't give you incentives to go to work. And this is the big problem. I'm for a welfare state, but a welfare state for the people who really cannot care for themselves. Poor, very poor people, handicapped, veterans, things like that. But, you know, it's not, you know, and now because of the crisis of the welfare state, because we've been promising everybody that everything is going to be fantastic and continue to be dependent of the state, but now the state shows its limit. In France, they cannot do everything anymore. There is joblessness. And I think, honestly, the warmth of a job, whatever a job, is so important for self-respect and dignity than being jobless and living off the state. I'm not criticizing that. I respect people who do that, but this is my view, and that's why I think America is absolutely, thank God that it's still in America that gives a very good example to Europe. This is my experience. Right.
Let me ask.
Yes, sir.
So you're describing a process of polarization. Yes. That's occurring. You have a new group arrives, it kind of settles in, it usually finds itself for a while at least on the bottom of the income distribution that's natural for migrants. There's always some tension between newcomers and old,
yes,
old set of populations. But then you have the development of this kind of radical, politicized form of Islamic spreads,
yes,
from the Persian Gulf mainly, through new media,
yes,
into various European communities. And this exacerbates the tensions. And if it creates violence, it exacerbates the tensions even more. And then you get a process of polarization in which both groups begin to define each other in terms of their hostile relations to the other community. The minority and the majority both see each other as opponents and maybe as enemies as time goes on. Once that process starts to proceed, in the Netherlands, it looks like it's gone fairly far and that there's now a large political party whose major purpose is to in some
to
way
kick out,
limit or contain or maybe even get rid of the Muslim population. How do you reverse that when it's gone as far as it has in the Netherlands, in France, particularly in those two countries, I'd say? How do you turn it around and produce something that reduces rather than increases, something that's not a vicious circle, but what they sometimes call a kind of benign circle, which things get better?
Yes, absolutely, a vicious circle. You know, I have a little chart I wanted to show you about the process of radicalization, but I will do it when if there is another question. I really think that the polarization in Europe, especially in Holland and France, got so far that it is impossible to stop this very negative spiral. It is becoming so dangerous. You know, if you look at the Netherlands, at the people who vote, for example, far right, look in America, we have, there is space, you can create gated communities. In Europe, we cannot create gated communities because it's very small. It's a very small country, it's overpopulated, and this is one, the overpopulation is a huge problem. The proximity to the Middle East is a problem. As long as we don't fix the problems of a little bit North Africa, and the Middle East, we will continue to have migration to Europe all the time. We see there are what you call boat people. People die every day in the Mediterranean Sea. The Italian police just helped 10,000 migrants from Africa coming to America. These are not Syrians. These are Africans. Sub-Saharan Africa has a huge demographic pressure on Europe. If you don't do economic development in these countries, first, economic development is very important to stabilize these countries and to keep people there to create a kind of hope or dream in these countries. Second,
who knows how to do that? That would take a long time.
What?
But who knows how to really do that?
We pumped a lot of money at the World Bank and
yeah,
things like that. I don't know. But there are ways maybe to do that. Second thing is democracy in these countries. Because if you don't create democracy in these countries, you will continue to have an ISIS ideology, you will continue to have an Al-Qaeda ideology everywhere, and it is transnational, it is not, something that you cannot make Holland or we have to live with that threat. In that sense, the only best thing is to invest in democracy, in these countries, and to work on the enlightenment of Islam itself, reforming Islam in interest. Because look, when I say Islam, it is really a container word. I'm talking about Muslims themselves. To do like Western or Europeans or make democracy more important than religion, in the sense that you create tolerance, you create diversity, you tolerate each other, and that doesn't happen a lot. And you could maybe don't like Ataturk. Remember Ataturk, the founder of the Turkish nation? When he created the first parliament, was in Ankara, he put the mosque lower than the parliament, saying the constitution is above religion. And it is really, it's not, why do Christians and Jews and others accept, also some Muslims, of course, majority of Muslims, accept, the constitution, accept, and it doesn't mean that they are less religious people. It doesn't mean that they don't love Christ or don't love Christianity or Moses. No, it's just because they want to be in society. This is what it calls religion in society. Religion in society has to behave in a way that is, tolerant to a certain limit. You know, it doesn't need to water down all your principles. But it means to be able to not to take arms against the people, but to talk through. I hope I said something.
One of the problems that some people perceive about Islam, you've got a certain group of people who come here because they think things are better here than where they left. And that's wonderful. They come here, they want to be like us. That's great. The problem is you get people that come and then they want us to become like them. That's not so great because we like it here, we like it to stay the way it is. And I've seen figures, and these are not from right-wing people, these are from Muslims.
Yes.
That they say somewhere between 30 and 50% of the Muslims in America think Sharia law is a great idea. Now, Sharia law is incompatible with Western democracy. And that's a real problem.
Yes.
I mean, you alluded to it with the Salman Rushdie thing.
Yes, I want to show you. Yes, I continue. I will show you one little thing. Just one little thing, I don't know where I put it. Anyway, I want to show you something. Sharia law itself, because in Islam there was the fiqh, which is jurisprudence, has been created for a long time. But Sharia as a word, codified as we know it now, has been really, there are two countries where it was created. It was Algeria, and it was by the French who created something called the Sharia law, le droit musulman, how to deal, since 1830, how to deal with the non-Muslims, to separate between Muslims and non-Muslims. And the British did it in India, a way to create. And then it is really, I'm talking here about the roots of what is called Sharia as the code itself. And later, the Muslims took this, especially the Islamist groups, as something really, it doesn't mean that Sharia doesn't exist in Islam or has not been existing as, as something. It means just, in Islam, Sharia means the way, a path. And it has never been so codified until the 19th century, actually, in the way we know it now. It was not codified before that, and it's still very vague and very, very problematic. And honestly, when people talk about the Sharia law, it's just because there is a kind of institutional ignorance within some Muslim communities about what it means, about the rules. And I think having public debates and having things about when you bring people who know about really what is Sharia and not Sharia, and have an open debate, will help people. When you bring people with a democratic deficit, let's be frank and honest. Most of Arab countries that represent 22% of all the Muslims in here in America, in the world, have a democratic deficit because they come from countries that are undemocratic. Indonesia is a great country, and it is in a way a democratic country. Malaysia is a democratic country. Turkey is to a certain extent a very democratic country. But most of the other countries are undemocratic. And then you camp with populations that need to know, that need to debate, that need the population that need to know how to behave in democratic settings. And I think the democratic culture is something that you learn to be acquired, and they didn't acquire it yet. And I think it can be the task of education, it can be the task of civil society in general, and it can be also the task of media or something else. I think people who have that have to know that they have a democratic deficit and they have to deal with it. And by imposing Sharia on American people or on European people is absolutely undemocratic. And we have to know there is one rule that we have in Western societies, is that you have to abide by democratic rules. That's it. And if somebody wants to introduce Sharia law, I'm very sorry. I mean, they tried to do it a little bit in Canada and in the UK and things like that. It's really, I think it's bizarre. It's bizarre that people, you live in modern societies and you want to introduce Sharia law. I mean, nobody tells you not to abide by the law in your own house, but don't impose it on me. I'm so sorry.
I don't accept it. We're going to have to bring this to a close. We're at 7 o'clock. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.